I dreamt a dream tonight. William Shakespeare, Romeo and Juliet. In the 1950s, space and space travel was the stuff of science fiction. It was everybody's boyhood dream to imagine traveling to the moon or Mars or even to some far-off galaxy. The Flash Gordon comic strip, first published in the USA in 1934, introduced the world to science fiction as it told the exploits of Flash Gordon's battles with Ming the Merciful. We had to wait until the 1960s before science fiction could become science fact. The Apollo dream started in the 1960s at a time when the Western powers, notably the USA and Europe, were confronting what they envisioned was the rising Soviet threat of communism. This period is now referred to as the Cold War. I do not intend to treat you to a summary of the Cold War, which I described in my previous two video series, and there are many better books and videos on this subject online. This excellent CNN 24-part production provides an overview of the Cold War. The full 24 episodes last over 18 hours, so if you cannot spare 2 days of your busy life, then try watching this snappy Cold War in 9 minutes version from John D. Ruddy. The only problem with this otherwise excellent video is that Mr. Ruddy seems to fantasize that the USA landed men on the moon. The fear in either camp was that one side might gain the advantage and place missiles in space or even on the moon. That would make their opponents an easy target, perhaps in some future conflict. In the Cold War, every catastrophic nightmare imaginable seemed a daily possibility. I remember those times very well. It was a time when one lived in an unreal fear of global devastation. The Cold War was not a real war as we understand conventional warfare, in which battles take place and soldiers and civilizations from both sides die, or large areas of civilization are declined, as in the First and Second World Wars. So, in the absence of any battles, deaths, or destruction, it was hard to know who was winning the Cold War. The lack of a yardstick by which to measure progress in the Cold War was quickly rectified. It became clear that progress could be judged by the proxy of the development of space technology. In reality, it was an arms race somewhat disguised as a race for space in the public eye. It was a race to develop long-range ballistic missiles to carry nuclear weapons. In this respect, Russia was seen to be in the lead as they had achieved several notable firsts in space technology. The first tangible evidence of progress came on October 4, 1957, when Russia announced that they successfully launched the first artificial satellite, Sputnik 1. This satellite was a small polished aluminum sphere, just 24 inches in diameter, which circled the Earth in an elliptical orbit for 3 weeks when the batteries died. It was not in a stable orbit, and it crashed back to Earth 2 weeks later. As a direct result of the Sputnik 1 satellite, President Dwight G. Eisenhower signed the National Aeronautics and Space Act, establishing NASA on 29th July 1958. When it began operations on 1st October 1958, NASA absorbed the 43-year-old National Advisory Committee of Aeronautics, NACA. NACA was a federal agency to undertake, to promote, and institutionalize aeronautical research. On February 5, 1959, NASA established a working group on lunar exploration. Members of NASA, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, JPL, the Army Ballistic Missile Agency, ABMA, the California Institute of Technology, and the University of California participated in the meeting. Preliminary studies showed that the Saturn booster, with an ICBM as the second stage and a center rocket in the third stage, would provide a capable carrier for manned lunar circumnavigation vehicles. It would also have the ability to carry instrumented packages of about 1 ton to land softly on the lunar surface. The report's summary states, "The present report presents ABMA's accomplishments in the study. It discusses all of the subject agreed upon by NASA and ABMA, including a recently assigned section on manned lunar landings. Many problems still exist, and further effort is necessary as described in Chapter 7 of this report. So, we have the beginning of the USA's desire to land men on the moon. This intention was almost a year before President Kennedy took office on 20 January 1961 and 2 years before the historical spaceflight of Yuri Gagarin. There were ideas as far back as 1955 to build a rocket to reach the moon as described by Wernher von Braun in a movie produced by no other than Walt Disney. The real shock announcement for the USA came on April 12, 1961. The Soviet Union declared that cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin had orbited the Earth in the capsule Vostok 1. As such, cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin was the first human to reach space and return safely to the Earth. Nikita Khrushchev, the Soviet leader at that time, did not lose any time to claim that space first demonstrated the superiority of the Soviet Union in space technology. Just out of interest, it may well be that Yuri Gagarin's story was not all that it was claimed to be, as described in this video from Spark, but that is another matter altogether. According to John Logsdon, who was a member of the NASA Advisory Council, President Kennedy had little interest in space exploration when he first moved into the Oval Office. However, the Gagarin flight worried Kennedy, and 2 days after he called in his advisors to formulate some response. He stressed that there was nothing more important than getting into the lead position in space technology. In a memo to Vice President Lyndon Johnson, he asked this question: "Do we have a chance of beating the Soviets by putting a laboratory in space, or by a trip around the moon, or by a rocket to go to the moon and back with a man? Is there any other space program which promises dramatic results which we could win?" On 20th April 1960, he laid down the challenge to his advisors: "Find me a space program which promises a dramatic result and that we can win." Just 5 weeks later, on 25th May 1961, President Kennedy delivered his now famous speech to Congress declaring the intention of the USA to put a man on the moon before the end of the decade. The more celebrated version of this speech was given later at Rice University. A valuable insight into the thinking of President Kennedy can be judged by his comments in the recording of the meeting he had on 21st November 1962 with his then NASA Administrator James E. Webb. When discussing priorities in space exploration, President Kennedy emphatically states, "Everything that we do ought to be tied into getting onto the moon ahead of the Russians." President Kennedy did subsequently appear to waver the expressed doubts about achieving his goal of sending man to the moon. On 20 September 1963 at the United Nations General Assembly, he offered to mount a joint manned lunar program with the Soviet Union. In a field where the United States and the Soviet Union have a special capacity, space, there is room for new cooperation for further joint efforts. I include among these possibilities a joint expedition to the moon. Soviet leader Nikita Khrushchev rejected the proposal, agreeing that his military brass that such an effort would provide an opportunity for the US military to learn more about Soviet missile programs. For Kennedy to make such an offer after his bombastic speech only 2 years earlier may indicate that Kennedy was having doubts about the US achieving his stated goal and getting men to the moon and bringing them back safely. There was no question in the minds of the US military leaders that Project Apollo must be a total success. It could not be allowed to fail, as American prestige was at stake. It would be achieved by fair means or foul. I believe that very early on, perhaps at the very beginning, a parallel Apollo simulation project was being considered to ensure that the project was seen to be successful and that the Americans would indeed land men on the moon and bring them back safely. Any such simulation project would need to be secretly organized by some clandestine organization working alongside but independent from NASA. I refer to this organization as NASA X to distinguish it from the real NASA. NASA X was probably set up and run by the Defense Intelligence Agency, DIA, perhaps assisted by the Central Intelligence Agency, CIA. The DIA is an intelligence agency of the United States federal government which specializes in defense and military intelligence. It was first established on 1st October 1961 under President John F. Kennedy by Defense Secretary Robert McNamara, interestingly, just 4 months after Kennedy's moon speech. So our story of intrigue and deceit begins. NASA has just 7 years to land men on the moon, and NASA X has 7 years to devise a method to convince the world that men had landed on the moon. Truth and belief. I pull in resolution and begin to doubt the equivocation of the fiend that lies like truth. William Shakespeare, Macbeth. One gigantic fraud. The Apollo Project is perhaps one of the greatest frauds in modern history. When it was perpetrated back in the 1960s, there were acceptable reasons for the deceit in a world precariously balanced on a nuclear knife edge when one wrong gesture or one careless move could have resulted in the devastation of immense proportions of humankind. It was a time when technological superiority ensured some measure of safety. As such, it was a benign lie with some credible purpose. As time passes, the deceit is no longer so benign. Perpetrated over 50 years, it has grave consequences for our future. It diminishes real technological advancement, it teaches falsehoods to our children, and encourages further deceit in space exploration. If you do not believe me, then witness some of the recent dubious videos supposedly from the International Space Station. The deceit was designed at a time when open access to information was minimal compared to what we have today. It was even more credible as it was played out in full view of the public gaze. Many elements of the missions were supposedly shown live on television. How honest can you get? Nothing was kept secret, as seemingly all was exposed for the scrutiny of the media. This openness was a crucial factor in convincing the world that the Apollo missions did land men on the moon. The deceit was successful at the time, and it has remained so for over 50 years, with the vast majority of the world's population still firmly convinced that it happened exactly as portrayed by NASA. I observe that many people who claim to believe that the Apollo missions were real, when questioned, know virtually nothing about the details of the alleged moon missions. Even so, they are quick to repudiate any suggestions that they may have been so gullible as to have been deceived so easily. There appears to be a faith, a zeal, almost on a par with a cult or religion, that their beliefs should never be doubted, let alone questioned. This phenomenon was very eloquently summed up by the investigative journalist, the late Dave McGowan, when he stated, "And yet, despite the fact that it was a relatively benign lie, there is a tremendous reluctance among the American people to let go of the notion that we sent men to the moon. There are a couple of reasons for that, one of them being that there is a romanticized notion that those were great years, years when one was proud to be an American. And, in this day and age, people need that kind of romanticized nostalgia to cling on. But that is not the main reason that people cling so tenaciously, often even angrily, to what is essentially an adult version of Santa Claus, the Easter Bunny, and the Tooth Fairy combined. What primarily motivates them is fear. But it is not the lie itself that scares people. It is what the lie says about the world around us and how it really functions. For if NASA was able to pull off such an outrageous hoax before the entire world and then keep the lie in place for four decades, what does that say about the control of information we receive? What does that say about media and the scientific community and the educational community and all the other institutions we depend on to tell us the truth? What does that say about the very nature of the world we live in? That is what scares the hell out of people and prevents them from even considering the possibility that they could have been so thoroughly duped. It's not being lied to about the moon landings that people have a problem with. It is the realization that comes with the revelation. If they could lie about that, then they could lie about anything. So how do we decide what is true? You may believe that it is an easy matter to decide what is genuine and what is not. The fact is that in certain areas, it is not so easy. We have a predisposed tendency to believe what we see in the mass media or from anyone labeled as expert in the subject under discussion. The obvious answer is to examine the evidence for ourselves. Unfortunately, we are often too declined to spend the time or we do not see the need. The evidence is there if we only take the time and the effort to research it. NASA has provided a copious amount of evidence which on the face of it irrefutably proves that the moon landings were factual. If the Apollo moon landings were faked, then we would expect the evidence provided by NASA to be fully conversant with their story of success. But it is not a matter of what NASA got right, but more importantly, what they got wrong. These errors in the NASA deceit are what we will highlight later in this video series. Once that rocket disappeared into the sky, the only evidence we have for what happened next is that emanating directly from NASA with no collaboration from any independent source. You can easily imagine that this would be a perfect scenario in which to manufacture a fake. There are no witnesses and no independent confirmation that the report events had taken place. Furthermore, the illusion of reality was cleverly enhanced by having live TV broadcasts from the moon, which proved to be compelling proof. As David Percy comments, "The idea that we went to the moon and that we were successful in our Apollo endeavors is so firmly embedded in the cultural lives of people on this planet that to voice the opinion that this might be untrue smacks of paranoia, and to present evidence for these doubts smacks of heresy." The question is simple: if NASA faked the moon landings and manufactured all of the evidence and photographs, videos, and mission transcripts, how could we ever prove it was a hoax? One would expect such a hoax to be perfectly fashioned, so it would be impossible to disprove and to show it was indeed a fake. But what if NASA has made some small unintentional errors in constructing the hoax? Let me employ an analogy. Like most analogies, it is not perfect, but it is robust enough to illustrate my point. 100 years ago, a previously unknown Rembrandt painting was discovered in an old warehouse. Together with the painting was also found a pile of documents which showed the provenance of the painting back to the great master Rembrandt himself. The painting was examined by experts, and the composition, technique, brush strokes, and signature had all been judged to be authentic to the style and technique of Rembrandt. A subsequent analysis of the paint pigments revealed the presence of titanium white, which was not available until the 20th century. Surely the painting must be a fake. Well, not quite. It may at first seem to be damning evidence of fakery, but it cannot be ruled out that the painting was retouched at a later date by some well-meaning restorer. So this evidence is what we may call debatable. In other words, we cannot on the face of it decide either way. However, further investigation on the canvas shows that it was a machine-woven canvas. Machine-made canvases were only manufactured 200 years after Rembrandt's death. Now we have conclusive proof that the painting must have been faked long after the death of Rembrandt, when the canvas type became available. This fact is conclusive proof that the painting was indeed a forgery. When dealing with a falsification of an object or event, it is important to realize that no amount of collaborative evidence can prove that the object or event is genuine. On the other hand, just one single piece of evidence is sufficient to prove conclusively that the object or event has been falsified. It is in this vein that we will view the Apollo evidence.
The Apollo evidence.
We all believe that we can judge what is true and what is not, but sometimes we can be deceived. Often our discussion about what we believe is based on incomplete research of the particular subject. We have a predisposition to accept what we see in the media as being factual. There is a long history in many countries of the truth being influenced by specific nefarious propaganda. There is a tendency to assume that all of the evidence that NASA shows us comes from the Project Apollo period of 1968 to 1972. But how do we know this? Certainly, it has all gradually appeared online with the advent of the internet in the mid-1990s. Before this, NASA had only showed us a few dozen selected photographs or video clips of the astronauts on the moon, mostly released as fodder for the media or as live TV transmissions at that time. It is possible that in the intervening period from 1972 to the mid-1990s, much more of this evidence was fabricated to complete the story. We shall probably never know the truth. The debate on the anomalies found in the Apollo evidence can often be dubious and inconclusive. We need to have a simpler approach and concentrate only on the aspects which are relevant in deciding if it was true or if it was an elaborate hoax. For simplicity, I have postulated four groups of evidence. For each group, I will provide some examples. I do this to put some order into the discussion. This approach will enhance the usefulness of various aspects of the debate. 1. Baseless concepts. In this group, I include all of the trivial nonsense often seen on the internet and in the mass media. The first obvious example is the Flat Earth Brigade, who, despite centuries of science, postulate that the Earth is not round, well, to be exact, an oblate spheroid, but completely flat. Their logic, therefore, is that rockets could not orbit a flat Earth and astronauts could never have reached the moon as described in the NASA story. In most versions of the flat Earth nonsense, the moon is also not even a planet, but some form of luminary, whatever that means. Heaven knows what science they need to invent to confirm such ludicrous beliefs. They believe that Antarctica and the South Pole do not exist. Instead, they postulate a giant ice wall which surrounds a circular, flat Earth. You may need a few beers to get your head around this one. Out of interest, one of the best debunks I have seen on the flat Earth nonsense is from Professor Dave. I am suspicious that the recent increase of flat Earth believers have been purposefully introduced by certain clandestine elements within the US government, perhaps the DIA or CIA. The object has been to denigrate all of the moon landing deniers by associating their beliefs with the flat Earth nonsense. It is now a widely held belief that if you doubt the official Apollo story, then you must also believe in the flat Earth theory. Unfortunately, this propaganda exercise has been extremely successful. A brief overview of the more recent growth of this flat Earth trivia is presented in this video from The Good Stuff. The second example of this nonsensicality is the fringe group who have an explanation as to why NASA has never returned to the moon for almost 50 years. They agree that the Apollo astronauts did land on the moon and return safely to Earth. However, they believe that on landing, they were confronted by moon aliens who warned them never to return. A typical example of this confused thinking is illustrated in this video from Entertainment Tonight. The problem with this premise is that NASA astronauts did return 5 more times. Perhaps the aliens relented on their threat. I cannot help but think that this is also some clandestine propaganda exercise. Another cold beer, anyone? I think that we can safely disregard all of the outlandish postulations which have no evidential foundation. Debatable facts! Now we move on to more evidence-based arguments. In this second group, we can identify aspects of the skeptics' claims for which there may be reasonable alternative explanations, but no factual data to decide which alternative is the true one. The first example concerns the absence of stars in the Apollo photographs and videos. The skeptics maintain that with no atmosphere, the stars would be visible in the blank lunar sky, but we never see stars in any of the Apollo material. The counter-argument to this offered by the pro-NASA group is that the brightness of the lunar surface was such that the exposure settings used on the cameras were too brief to register the faint light from the stars. All very plausible. Without any further collaboration, it is impossible to decide what is the fact, stars or no stars. Our only witnesses to this were the Apollo astronauts themselves, and they state that there were no visible stars observable from the lunar surface. Of course, this beggars the obvious question. Why, with such a great opportunity, didn't the astronauts adjust the exposure settings on their cameras? They would have been able to capture what must have been a wondrous view of the heavens. In subsequent missions, they could have taken special cameras and film to capture these important star images. They didn't, and one wonders why not. The second example concerns the radiation from the Van Allen radiation belts. These eponymous radiation belts were first identified in 1958 by Dr. James Van Allen in a paper published in the Scientific America magazine. In this paper, he warned of the extreme dangers for astronauts passing through these radiation belts. He even estimated the amount of radiation that would be suffered by the astronauts. His calculations show that the astronauts could potentially be exposed to extremely dangerous radiation. The skeptics maintain that the Apollo astronauts would have suffered life-threatening exposure to this radiation. According to the published NASA figures, the actual radiation received by the astronauts was minimal, no more than the exposure that one would be received from a couple of chest x-rays. The pro-NASA group also state that the path taken by the Apollo spacecraft was such that the astronauts avoided much of the dangerous area of the Van Allen belts, although this is untrue. We will examine this in more detail later on in this video series. Again, it is not possible on the evidence available to determine what is fact and what is not. The astronauts have survived into normal old age. They have shown no apparent signs of illness caused by any exposure to the high levels of radiation. It could mean that the NASA figures on radiation exposure are accurate, or simply that no astronaut has traversed the Van Allen radiation belts. Mary Bennett, a co-founder of Owlist.com, has produced an in-depth assessment of the state of knowledge concerning the radiation challenge facing Orion, now renamed Artemis. What is interesting in this paper is the conclusion that the NASA published radiation dosages for the Apollo missions are out of sync with more recent data collection on radiation in space. I cannot help but feel that continuing to defend the idea of the Apollo hoax in this regime of discussion only leads to a pointless, continuously circular debate with the pro-NASA crowd. I am not in any way saying that most of these anomalies suggested by the skeptics are irrelevant, as I believe the majority have some merit. However, we do not progress the debate any further if we confine ourselves to debating in this contentious area.
Improbable circumstances.
The third group is interesting in that it concentrates on the elements of the Apollo narrative that at first sight appear to be highly improbable or do not in themselves conclusively prove any fakery. They nonetheless cause one to question the veracity of the story. The first example concerns the Van Allen radiation belts. These belts of high radiation were known to present a danger to the astronauts. We would therefore have expected that Apollo mission control would have some concerns about the safety of the astronauts as they passed through these belts of dangerous radiation. The first Apollo mission to pass through these radiation belts was alleged to be Apollo 8 on 21 December 1968. One would have expected mission control to be feverishly checking what level of radiation the astronauts were experiencing on Apollo 8 and how they were feeling as they were hurling through the Van Allen radiation belts. Such checks should have been crucial, as any deliberation of the astronauts to perform their tasks could have resulted in mission failure and even possibly the death of the astronauts. It may surprise you to know that as the astronauts traverse the Van Allen radiation belts, there is no mention of these belts of radiation nor any request for Geiger counter readings in the mission transcripts. NASA state that the mission transcripts cover all communications between the astronauts and mission control in Houston. This omission appears to be a highly improbable event. Is it feasible that NASA mission control could have shown such scant disregard for the health of the astronauts and the success of the mission given the known possible dangers of the Van Allen radiation belt? The second example covers why NASA stopped moon missions after the final mission of Apollo 17 in 1972 following the cancellation of Apollo missions 18, 19, and 20. At the time of writing this video series in late 2020, there have been no attempts to send any more manned missions to the moon by the US or any other nation. NASA has been developing deep space projects since 2004 under various names, Orion, Constellation, and now Artemis, but so far they have shown no likelihood of returning to the moon at best until 2024, as recently mandated by President Trump. It is difficult to mention any other technological achievement in the history of man that suddenly stopped with no ongoing development. If any of the Apollo missions had successfully reached the moon, then we would have expected continuing scientific and commercial development of the resources on the moon. We should have seen moon bases, exploration of minerals, and many other scientific ventures, but after more than 50 years, we have nothing. This fact must also be compared to the timescale supposedly achieved in the Apollo project. On December 24, 1968, just 7 years and 5 months after President Kennedy announced on 25th July 1961 the proposed mission to the moon, the Apollo 8 astronauts were supposedly orbiting the moon. When President Kennedy announced the goal of reaching the moon, only one American, Alan Shepard, had been briefly into space, and even that was just about 1 minute on the 15-minute suborbital mission. So we are left with a comparison that back in the 1960s, the USA managed to develop the means to reach the moon in less than 8 years, whereas in the second millennium, it will at best take more than 20 years to achieve the same thing, and this is assuming that any nation finally sends men to the moon. The vast difference between the technology available to NASA in the 1960s and that developed in the following 50 years is mind-blowing. So, in theory, it should now be much easier to reach the moon. What is most surprising is that NASA now sees the radiation in the Van Allen belts and the radiation beyond these belts as a primary cause for concern. However, their own published radiation data for the Apollo project shows that the astronauts received very minimal radiation. Undeniable facts. In this final group, we have those aspects of the Apollo story that expose the fakery beyond any reasonable doubt. It is this group of evidence-based facts that prove that the Apollo astronauts did not reach the moon or come even close, and that the clandestine elements within NASA perpetrated the moon landing hoax. Such analysis is based on physical laws and astute observation, as we shall discover. There are several distinct differences between the Earth and the Moon, namely the atmosphere and the gravitational force. It is these physical differences that can show us the real evidence of the fakery. The first important aspect is the difference in the gravitational forces on the Earth and on the Moon. This difference is due to the relative sizes and the varying composition of the two planets. The gravitational force on the Earth is about 6 times that on the Moon. The second crucial difference is the lack of any real atmosphere on the Moon. Any attempts to fake the Apollo videos must account for the effects of the significant difference in the gravitational forces. NASA conducted many experiments with specifically designed equipment to simulate the reduced gravity on the Moon. NASA produced several types of harnesses and wire supports in an attempt to replicate the lesser gravity. These experiments were designed primarily to train the astronauts and to get them accustomed to the effects of the lesser lunar gravity. In all probability, these same devices were utilized to create the fake footage that NASA produced that convinced the world that they had achieved the most significant event in human history. Even though NASA cleverly tried to simulate the lesser gravity on the Moon, unfortunately for them, it is one of those areas for which we can demonstrate that the videos were faked here on the Earth. We will show this convincing evidence later on in this series, exposing the deceit. The second area of interest is the Moon's atmosphere, or to be more precise, the lack of it. Sound is transmitted as compression waves through our atmosphere here on Earth. On the Moon, there is no atmosphere, so there should be no transmitted sound. In case you missed it at school, here is the video of the bell jar sound experiment. In the majority of the NASA videos allegedly filmed on the Moon, there is no sound to be heard except the astronauts' conversations between themselves and with mission control. Unfortunately for the perpetrators of the fraud, there are several instances in which sound is audible, impossibly transmitted through the non-atmosphere. We will show irrefutable evidence of this later on in Exposing the Deceit. Why is such a categorization important? This categorization is important because we see that almost exclusively the pro-NASA believers restrict their discussions within Category 2, debatable facts, concentrating on a few standardized anomalies as their debunking exercise. We do not see much debate from the pro-NASA camp within the more revealing Category of 3, improbable facts, and almost nothing in Category 4, undeniable facts. There are good reasons for this, in that it is within these areas that their defense of the official Apollo story totally fails. Unfortunately, the Apollo deniers fall into this trap and obviously continue to debate within these restricted areas, which are purposefully selected by the pro-NASA camp. I believe it is time for the Apollo moon landing deniers to concentrate on asking questions within Group 3 and 4. The proof of the fakery lies within this regime and poses questions which are difficult for the pro-NASA devotees to answer. It is therefore crucial to choose this battleground rather than fall prey to the pro-NASA preferred area of debate in which they have already formulated their dubious answers. Thank you.